the capsule was coming down, just briefly tell me your reaction that moment that it splashed down.
So when they called capture from the helicopters, it was the most amazing feeling. It's just been a long time coming. We've been working this mission for a while, and we've done a ton of training. And every time you do training with a mock-up capsule, you don't have any of that. You don't have parachutes. You don't, you know, hear it coming back through the atmosphere, the sonic booms and all of that kind of stuff. And today that actually happened. It's just amazing.
And your team, it's worth noting, has been out here a long time. From the moment of launch, you were on console, ready to support if something off-nominal happened, unusual, you were going to be able to recover that capsule wherever it was needed to recover. So you were working that and then stayed through Thanksgiving all the way to now. So it's been a long road.
It has been, yes. Several of us supported launch, and then we deployed out here about 23 days before, and we're out here for Thanksgiving as a team. So we have been waiting for this and preparing for it for a while.
And it looks like you're doing a great job so far. Good luck the rest of the way, Melissa Jones, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
All right. Rob?
Thank you, Daryl. We'll be back to you on the USS Portland here shortly as the post-splashdown activities and the recovery operations will continue. As mentioned earlier, it will take about 2 hours from the time of splashdown until the time that Flight Director Judd Freeling and his team of entry flight controllers here will hand the vehicle over to the Exploration Ground System recovery team that will work over the next several hours to bring the Orion into the well deck of the USS Portland. With me, a familiar face, Bob Cabana, NASA's Associate Administrator. Bob, it's great to see you here. And with Orion back on Earth, another milestone accomplished on the road back to putting Americans on the surface of the moon. In terms of the criticality of what we've seen over the past 4 weeks, your thoughts on how this mission evolved and now the stepping stone that would put a crew on board a couple of years from now?
Oh, Rob, it's been absolutely critical to get this mission off safely. This test flight is what we need in order to prove this vehicle so that we can fly with a crew, and that's the next step, and I can't wait. You know, the launch, first off, I was on the roof of the Launch Control Center. I went up there with the administrator and deputy administrator when we came out of the T-minus 10-minute hold, and it was phenomenal. It was absolutely amazing. The rocket performed flawlessly, and I haven't been that happy in a long time after we came down off the roof. And then to see the mission go as well as it did, the shots that we got from the vehicle, that one from 40,000 miles away where you saw the moon with the Earth in the background. And then this morning, I mean, we've learned how to operate this vehicle. A few minor glitches along the way, but it has performed flawlessly. And we're learning how to work with it, operate it. And that's what this JSC team does. It is so great to be back here in Mission Control, to be with the ops team. I'm so proud of these guys. Amazing. But if you were watching this morning, I love the video. I don't know if it was on NASA TV or not, but the Earth just kept getting bigger and bigger. It was really hauling as it came in. And the preciseness with which they were able to bring it down and seeing the chutes come out, it's just, I'm so proud of this team, the Orion team, the entire SLS, Artemis team, the folks here at JSC. It's just been amazing. Now, I wish Gene Cernan were still alive. You know, here we are on the 50th anniversary, and Gene was such a proponent of getting us back to the moon. I wish he were alive to have seen this mission. It would have meant a lot to him.
I don't want to date you, but I think 24 years ago, right this at this moment in time, you were building a space station, I believe, with your crew on STS-88. We had so many dramatic, jaw-dropping images during the course of this flight. What for you was the most impactful moment?
I'm not sure I can pick one. Obviously, the launch. The team has worked so hard to get to the point where we successfully launched this rocket. I think the successful burns along the way to actually get that go for the TLI burn and do it and be on our way to the moon again, absolutely awesome. I think the pictures that we saw. But the splashdown, how can you not? I mean, this was really emotional going around and congratulating folks for what we did. So it's hard to pick just one. I think what has meant the most to me, more than just watching the mission, more than the mission highlights, is being with the teams at the Kennedy Space Center, at the Marshall Space Flight Center, here at the Johnson Space Center, and just being able to go up and talk to them and thank them for all their hard work that got us to where we are. I think it means a lot to me.
And Bob, final question. The next step, Artemis II, putting a crew on a vehicle to orbit the moon. It's going to be a complicated mission. It's a long road. It seems like a long time from now, but based on what we've just witnessed and based on what we believe will be the ultimate data flow out of this mission, doesn't seem that far away, does it?
It is not that far away. It's going to mean a lot when we get the crew assigned. And we see them in training. We get that human face to this. I've seen the flight hardware, KSC, the Orion 2 spacecraft for Artemis 2 is there. It's in build. We got to get Artemis 1 back and transfer some of the black boxes across to make sure that they get checked out and everything works. You know, the rocket's being built. We are on the way. And I think when you put a human face to that, when you actually see that, hey, we're sending humans to the moon again, and we're going to get this one-year cadence eventually where we're doing this on an annual basis, this is our future, and it's different from how we went during Apollo. We're going in a sustainable way. We're paving the way to go on to Mars, not just the moon and Mars, but to establish a presence in our solar system beyond our home planet, to explore, to have those technologies in space, to continue to learn and improve things here on planet Earth.
Bob Cabana, NASA's Associate Administrator. Thanks so much for being with us, Bob.
Rob, it is always a pleasure to share a mic with the voice of NASA. I think a lot of you, buddy, you know that. We've worked together a long time. You keep doing a great job.
Thank you very much, Bob. Bob Cabana, NASA's Associate Administrator, with us here in Mission Control. This is Mission Control Houston. About 37 minutes since Orion splashed down in the Pacific on the deck of the USS Portland, as he has been throughout the course of the morning. Daryl Nail, my colleague from the Kennedy Space Center. Daryl, how are things going out there? It looks like you're about to approach the vehicle.
Yeah, we're very close to that moment, Rob, here on the USS Portland. We're just about 100 miles off the coast of Baja, Mexico. The operation, as you've heard and been commentating, it is going pretty smoothly at this point. But we are in a pre-planned waiting period as we wait for the ammonia that is inside the capsule. It is used for cooling. This is boiling off at this moment into the atmosphere. And until that's complete, the boats will be on hold. Now, the Navy divers right now at this moment are outside of the 120-yard radius around the capsule. That was part of the plan. They will close within just a few feet to start detecting if there are any hazardous gases coming from the capsule. But that will only happen once our recovery director, Melissa Jones, has given them the go to close in. The ship, meanwhile, the USS Portland, is on its way to close within 2,000 yards of the capsule. As you can see it floating there, the bags fully inflated that are used to upright it, bright orange in color at the top of the capsule. The ship will then come alongside the capsule. And once the Navy divers have gone in and made sure that the capsule is safe to approach. They will begin taking imagery, photographs, both on the top side of the water, and then also they have Navy divers prepared to go underneath the capsule and take pictures of the heat shield. The all-important component of this capsule, which is the primary objective in terms of the test and this flight test, is to make sure that that heat shield works and works well. So fresh from space, they want to make sure that they have images of it preserved as it is now before the operation begins, where they pull it into the well deck of the USS Portland. That will involve the attachment of ropes as well as a winch line that then connects to the USS Portland. The well deck of the USS Portland will be flooded to about 6 feet, and those Navy boats will attach their lines and then pull alongside the Navy vessel, connect to a winch line, and then carefully tow it into the well deck. Again, we are currently awaiting the completion of ammonia boil-off from the capsule. They've allowed for up to 2 hours, but it could